And the paper presented to the conference is not advocating for a public ownership. The public ownership has some advantages, but at the same time has some disadvantages. The private ownership has some advantages and some disadvantages. The important thing is to be sure that every country has a real land use control. What the paper says, and I think that is one of the innovative, really innovative approach of the documents taken to the conference, is that the profits, that not, let me say, that the activity of transforming rural land into urban land must be a government activity. That cannot be left to the private sector. It's something similar what had happened 100 years ago when the private people used to issue money. As you remember, 100 years ago, the commercial banks used to issue money until the moment that the government realized that was something important to be left to the private sector, that the government must have the monopoly of the issue of money. Something similar must happen with the transfer of the rural, the agricultural land to the urban land, because it's like a modern alchemy. You are taking land whose value by hectare is one, and from the day to the night, transferring it in other completely different good that is urban land, whose value is 10, 20, or 100. That must be controlled completely by the government.
I believe this lady here was first, and then we'll take you, and then I have a gentleman over there. Please.
I'm Fran Hoskin, Women's International Network News. I wanted to ask you, I see neither in the Declaration of Principles nor in any of the other documents an official recognition of the previous conferences, specifically the Environment Conference that has led up to this one, the Population Conference, and also the IWY Conference, International Women's Year Conference. All of these conferences have produced very important documents that provide the human input to a large extent to the physical design, and they are not sufficiently, or they are, don't seem to be recognized in any of the present preparatory conferences. Will they be later recognized? Is this an oversight, or will something be done about officially recognizing these very important world plans of action that the countries have, the different states have approved and dealt with, and I don't see anywhere that they are specifically mentioned?
Let me say that we have considered that this conference is not the only one that has been held under the auspices of the UN in this decade. We consider it just a part of a process, and we mention it specifically in the Declaration of Principles, in Chapter 3, Article 13, when we say specifically, in the planning and management of human settlements, governments should take into consideration all pertinent recommendations of previous United Nations conference dealing with the quality of life, starting with the high priority given to the environmental impact of human settlements, Stockholm, the housing and sanitary ramification of population growth, Bucharest, rural development and the need to increase food supply, Rome, and the effect on women of housing and urban development, Mexico City.
All right. And back here.
Mr. Penalosa, the provisional agenda implies a major effort will be undertaken to facilitate greater information exchange within and between the nations. Do you see a new agreement emerging regarding unrestricted flow of information between the nations? And will the socioeconomic and political implications of such an information flow be also under consideration by the conference?
Yes, I think that one of the main points when you talk about programs for international cooperation is the one of interchange of information. Among all reasons for the lack of a suitable and adequate institutional arrangement at the international level, up to now has not been a minimum system of interchange of information. I consider that one of the main functions of any new institutional arrangement dealing with human settlements must be to improve or to create, in many cases, system to the interchange, the free interchange of information. In other areas, agriculture, education, many other areas, there are channels, known channels, to promote this interchange of information. Unfortunately, on human settlements, there are very few channels of information. I bet you, for example, that very few of you are aware of what is happening, suppose, in connection with urban development in Singapore. And I think that they have been taking in Singapore very innovative approaches towards urban development. Maybe very few of you know what has been happening towards rural development in Tanzania. And I think that this has been one of the most innovative approaches towards rural development and rural settlements in the history of the world. And if it is to many of you that are working in the media, I can bet you that very few ministers or policymakers dealing with human settlements are aware of those developments, because there are not established network of to interchange information all around the world.
Will you therefore be considering the role of communications technologies and technological decisions in communications within the nations and between nations within this conference as they pertain to human settlements?
No doubt, and let me say, I think that just the fact that for the first time in history, this conference is going to use the audiovisual media as integral part of the conference, is just a demonstration of in the way that we are approaching, from the point of view of the Secretariat, the use of the different instruments available. And let me say, this morning, I was a witness of the inauguration of the Center for Human Settlements in the University of British Columbia, that is going to be devoted mainly, this is just an example, for the interchange of information, not only the audiovisual information, but the written information, another kind of information. But a major effort must be developed in many ways, not only worldwide, but regional basis, to improve, because there is a lot of, I am convinced that any country has something to teach and something to learn from the others. But if you don't organize, as you say, a system of interchange of information, that's not going to happen.
I think in the interest of fairness, we ought to get around here. This gentleman has been waiting.
Bill Joyner, CJLR Radio, Vancouver. Mr. Penulers, right at the beginning of your statement here, and I paraphrase you, this will be a political conference in the broad sense of the word, that is the right approach. I don't want to read too much into this. Are you making any direct reference here to the PLO-Israeli confrontation that we're expecting?
No. For that reason, I add the words in the broad sense of the word. When I talk about politics, I'm talking about the broad definition of politics. It's how to rule, how to govern the countries, the peoples. And when I say that what is very valid here are political decisions, are decisions that is under the responsibility of the governments, and not, and when I am saying that it's not a technical problem, I am saying that what is valid is not to discover new technology or new instruments, technological instruments. I am not referring to these points that are in this moment can be in the international political atmosphere, but it's not in the broad sense of the word. doesn't fit in the broad sense of the word of politics.
Well, do you think this broad issue should be brought up at this conference?
I don't think that this is the forum for that kind of discussion. For that kind of discussion, there is the General Assembly, the Security Council. There are instruments within the UN very suitable to discuss this kind of very important problems.
Thank you.
All right, and then we'll take this young lady. This gentleman already at the microphone. Why don't you move over there for your turn?
I just wanted to ask, the Habitat Forum has already dealt with a panel discussion on human rights, and one of the issues that possibly this conference could have dealt with in the Declaration of Principles but doesn't seem to is the question of political prisoners and concentration camps or psychiatric institutions used to incarcerate political prisoners. Is there, doesn't the Declaration of Principles as such sort of skirt this issue, sir, or do you feel, how do you feel the Declaration of Principles deals with this issue?
One of the problems of dealing with human settlements is that really human settlements cover everything. And theoretically, you can have arguments to include in the Declaration of Principles anything. But that was the reason why the preparatory committee first and then the General Assembly approved an agenda. Of course, the conference is completely free and is sovereign to do what it wants. And my work is going to finish on Monday at 11 o'clock. And 11 o'clock a.m. is up to the governments. My work is already done at that moment.
I think this young lady down here is next. She's writing away.
Do you mean to say, in reply to question one, that solutions to housing problems are exclusively provided by bureaucratic institutions? In view of what you said in relation to the information network, I would suggest that perhaps one should envisage alternatives as very good information networks on urban settlements dealing with housing the poor do exist.
Yeah. I like very much this question because that gives me the opportunity of stating very clearly another point. I think that the main factor to construct the human settlements that are going to be needed in the next 25 years, that we need in the next 25 years settlements for an equivalent amount of the settlement that exists today. That means settlements for more than 3 billion people, being very optimistic, are not going to be the consequence of the direct action of the governments. 90% of the housing that exists right now has not been constructed by the governments, has not been constructed by the public by the private companies. 90% of the housing that exists in the world has been constructed by the people that live in it, that are the poor people. They have not been constructed by architects, by engineers, by themselves. The poor people have been constructed this housing. And this is going to happen in the next 25 years. We don't need to kid ourselves about. With the so-called low-income housing projects, up to now doesn't reach near 30% of the population of the world for economic reasons. They are out of the economic possibility of 70%, as Mr. McNamara very rightly had pointed out last year. Then we cannot hope that through direct government action or through private profit action, we are going to solve our housing. No, are the people, then the government is going just to be in position to cooperate, to help. And let me give you a case, a good example. Most of the squatter settlements that exist all around the world have been just a response of the lack of inadequacy of the legislation to the real situations. Most of the construction codes that exist in many of the countries of the world are not adapted needs of the majority. Then the people need to live in a place. Then they need to construct their houses against the law because they need to survive. I have been just shocked in many countries looking at the construction code of a very poor and a very underdeveloped country is just the copy, the textual copy of the London Code or the New York Code. And what it means? Nothing. Then I think that the whole approach needs to be changed. I would say that in many countries, many of the so-called public housing projects must be even suspended and change in programs to help the people help themselves. Because the important thing is that you need to approach the majority, or if possible, all the population, not a minority. Most of the so-called public housing projects have been just creating privileged minorities that are so lucky that they can have a public housing. But this is not a possibility for the majority.
All of UN would be to create this new approach?
Let me say first of all, because many people make that mistake, the UN is not a super government. The UN is just a parliament where the government meets to discuss, to talk as the parliaments in the different countries. Then the UN can do as much as the government wants, nothing else. Then that needs to be just, as I already mentioned, a reflection, a consequence of what the different countries want at the national level and what the different countries want as cooperation, as contribution from the international community. But the UN cannot do more than that. It depends on what are the recommendations that are approved here, what are the recommendations that later are going to approve the General Assembly and in the other UN meetings. The secretariat are just a group of bureaucrats that we try to follow the advice, the request of the governments.
Do you have a Gary Curtis, Vancouver Sun. Do you have any remarks on Chilean and Palestinian requests for statements or resolutions coming from the conference regarding conditions in their home areas? Do you have any remarks on Chilean or Palestinian requests for statements or resolutions coming from the conference regarding conditions in their home areas?
I am not aware of any request from the Chileans or the Palestinians about it. Let us see what happens when the conference starts.
This was carried on the CBC National News Radio this morning.
Unfortunately, I have been, as you can imagine, so busy that I was not able to watch the...
Could you comment on this now?
I don't know what's what they want or what they are proposing.
Okay.
The lady back there?
It would seem that in the last half a century, it wasn't so much lack of government controls of land that permitted all it was... It wasn't so much a lack of that permitted the gigantic overgrowth of so many urban areas in the world, but that most planners and government decision makers held this to be either inevitable or even desirable. Do you think, in the view of that there's any hope that this conference can do anything constructive about slowing down or reversing this trend, which is one of the basic elements in the problem of human habitation?
I am also grateful for your question, because really I think that I hope that one of the main byproducts of this conference is to convince the leaders, the governments, and the public opinion that they cannot live any longer to the spontaneous process, the settlement of their population. That within their national policies on human settlements, one essential element must be a policy on the distribution of the population in the national territory. X is up to each country to decide what do they want. But as you rightly point out, up to now, this has been left to the spontaneous process. Every boy thinks that something inevitable, that the most of the cases the governments are just trying to face or to solve the problems created, but nobody thinks that something can be done about. And I think that, let me compare with economic development planning. Until the Second World War, to talk about economic development planning was something simple, because only the Soviets were the ones planning the economic development, at least saying that they were planning it. The Second World War proved all the world that the economic development planning was something that couldn't be left to the spontaneous process or to the market forces. That regardless the political system, every country should have an economic development planning. I would say that from this conference, one of the main consequences should be to convince the governments, to convince the public opinion, that the physical planning of the country cannot be left to the spontaneous and, in most of the cases, the chaotic process, that is possible to plan. Suppose, take you the case of my own country. I'm from Colombia. Being very optimistic, in the next 25 years, Colombia right now has between 24 and 25 million. In the next 25 years, we are going to have 20 million people more. The government must establish a policy with the backing and the understanding of the public opinion where these 20 million people are going to be settled. In what regions of the country? In what kind of settlements? In small towns, middle-sized cities, big metropolitan areas? Of what kind of network of settlements? And more than that, what kind of service? And in many cases, ministers from the economic development side. Because we must convince the people dealing with economic development of the countries that they must integrate with economic development of the countries the physical development of the countries.
Yes. Oh, did you have a further question? No, please.
I have a new question.
Right.
One of the very important issues pertaining to human settlements is the freedom of movement of peoples. In your opinion, can you say that sanctions could be provided at this conference in the case of governments who do not recognize this as a principle?
This is not a matter of the conference. This is a political point that must be taken into other forums. There are a different kind of freedom of movement. And I am not in position to discuss about it, but this is not the kind of points that I think that should be taken to the conference, because it belongs more to the side of the human rights, and we cannot intend to cover in this conference everything in the world. We are not going to solve or to recommend about all the points. Of course, I am very much in favor of the freedom, the real freedom of movement, nationally and internationally, but and when I talk, for example, about a policy on the distribution of the population of the national territory, there are different systems to achieve it. For that reason, I am saying that must be integrated with economic development planning, because the construction of a new factory or the construction of a new highway are essential factors to induce the people to move to one place or to another. The construction of a very good high school in one place or in another is going to induce these people to stay there or to move to another town. In the developing world, and I'm talking about mainly about Latin America, one of the main reasons of the migration to some cities has been the educational facilities. Unfortunately, the elites of the provincial towns had moved to the big cities, leaving out of leaders the provincial groups. Why? Because they look for educational facilities for their children. Then, in some cases, just the construction of a good high school is going to induce the people to stay there or to leave the city.
If I may, then you do agree that that this principle should be connected with the economic and other processes that the conference will take up.
I repeat that if you want, you can find arguments to include in the agenda of the conference anything connecting with any activity of mankind.
Good answer.
Mr. Penuloza, once again, not to read anything into what you've said. Several things you've commented on seem to summarize by saying that free enterprise is on the way out. You're saying that you cannot leave the problems of settlement to spontaneous development, that land speculators have no place, and that governments must be involved in all areas of planning. Now, this may be true in some countries, but do you think this is true in North America?
Let me say that, of course, this is my personal opinion. I think that the case of the U.S., let us take this case. The U.S. has so many resources that they can, up to now, afford living without planning. But, and this is the reason, I think that not having planning is just a luxury thing. You are paying a cost for it. And I don't have the figures, but there is a very, very expensive proposition to just leave it to the spontaneous process. And as you know, that right now the U.S. Congress, there is a legislation proposed by some eminent senators asking to introduce economic development planning for the first time in the U.S. And let me say another thing and story. That the U.S. has been preaching all of our countries to establish systems and policies of economic development planning. And unfortunately, up to now, they are the only ones without it. And the reason is because they can afford to live without it. But I think that has been a very expensive proposition, and I think that no doubt, doubt about it. Maybe this is we are living in a democracy, fortunately. The U.S. people prefer to pay that cost or not. This is up to them.
Thank you.
Look, we have held Mr. Penuloza now for about an hour, so I want to entertain just one more question. We will have an opportunity to meet with him again during the conference. This gentleman here, I think, has been waiting rather patiently for some time.
Thank you. Mike Trelevna of the Portland, Oregonian, Portland, Oregon. Mr. Secretary, at UN conferences in the past few years and at the conference just going on now in Nairobi, the Trade and Development Conference, there have been sharp disagreements between industrial countries and third world states on distribution of incomes and wealth and so on. Do you expect those disagreements to be reflected at this conference and to disrupt the progress of this conference?
I think that, of course, the theme of the any new economic order is a natural theme of the UN already, fortunately, I think. But as I have been saying, it's very important to have a redistribution of resources among nations. But I think that it's even more important, a redistribution of resources within nations. Very little is going to be achieved only with a redistribution of resources among nations. And one of the main themes of the conference, when you look to the item of the agenda on shelter, services, infrastructure, and in certain way land, you are dealing with the point that in most of the countries there are enough resources to fulfill the minimum needs. I am not talking about wishes, needs of everybody in connection with human settlements. The problem is that in most of the countries there are a minority overusing the resources available, with the consequence that there are not resources left to provide the minimum needs of the majority. This is the case of most of the developing countries where we have a dual society, a minority enjoying a European or North American style of life, and a majority without anything. And because in some cases imposed through the colonial powers, in other case, just for a status symbol, we have been just copying the style of life of the of Europe or North America, with the consequence that we have developed this kind of dual society. There are no hope, and I want to be very clear about it, to provide your style of life here in Canada or in the States or in Europe to the rest of the world. That's out of any physical possibility. Because even here in Canada and the US and Northern and Europe, you are just in the end of this kind of style of life. Very soon there are not going to be enough physical resources to keep it. Then we must develop a new style of life with the resources available by which we can provide the minimum needs to everybody.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Penaloza. We'll look forward to meeting you again. Just one further word. I forgot to mention this earlier in my announcements. At the 5 p.m. briefing tomorrow, Sunday, we will also be giving out the tickets for the opening ceremony on Monday, and all media will be required to have tickets. We will also be allocating location passes for our visual friends.
Let me say the last word. Here in Vancouver, during these 2 weeks, in the forum, as in the official conference, there are going to be many, many people, real experts or policy makers with a long experience in the problems of human settlements, with wonderful ideas, wonderful approaches. The only thing that I hope is that you can grab them to get interviews or their points of view, because this is going to help the public opinion of other countries and even the public opinion of their own countries. Thank you.
Thank you. That was great.